Good morning and welcome back. Myself, Dr. Jibran Ahmed presents to you Simply Pathology, and today we are back with a very important lecture. The topic of today's discussion is paraneoplastic syndrome. Now, this syndrome is a very, very common question. It is also a very, very scoring topic. But despite being an easy topic, I don't know why many students are making a lot of errors in this particular topic. So let us understand without wasting any time about paraneoplastic syndrome. So what is the paraneoplastic syndrome? So certain individuals who are suffering from cancer, they are going to develop such signs and symptoms that cannot be explained by the anatomical distribution of that tumor or by the elaboration of the hormones which are indigenous to the tissue from which the tumor is arising. Okay. These are known as paraneoplastic syndrome. So such constellation of signs and symptoms which cannot be explained, okay, by the anatomical location of the tumor or by the elaboration of the hormones which are indigenous to the tissue from which the tumor is arising. Okay. So I know you have not understood the definition completely. I will explain you with the help of an example. Okay, stay tuned. Now the paraneoplastic syndrome is occurring in about 10% of the individuals with cancer. Now, the paraneoplastic syndrome, it might be the earliest manifestation of an occult neoplasm. So, occult means a neoplasm which is hiding, which has not revealed itself, okay, or which has not come, under detection. Paraneoplastic syndrome in affected patient, they can cause significant clinical problems, and sometimes it might be fatal as well. And sometimes a paraneoplastic syndrome might mimic as a metastatic disease, and it might create a lot of confusion, okay, and therefore it might confound the treatment. Okay. So basically the paraneoplastic syndrome is divided into five headings. One is endocrinopathy, nerve and muscle syndrome, dermatological disorders, osseous articular soft tissue changes, vascular and hematological changes. So the first heading is endocrinopathy, and with the first example, that is the Cushing syndrome, I am going to explain you what a paraneoplastic syndrome is. So try to understand and listen to me carefully. So we have all read about Cushing's disease. Mind it, I am using the term Cushing disease, not syndrome. So Cushing disease, why does Cushing disease occur? It occurs because of excessive secretion of corticotrophins or ACTH from the pituitary. And when will the pituitary secrete excessive amounts of ACTH? In cases of tumors of the pituitary, for example, in case of pituitary adenoma. So if there is a pituitary adenoma, that is going to excessively secrete the ACTH, and then there will be Cushing's disease, not syndrome. So this is the normal thing, okay? Excessive production of ACTH is there from an expected site, that is the pituitary. Okay, but for example, if a person is suffering from lung cancer, that lung cancer, okay, the cancer, the tumor, the lung tumor now itself is secreting an excessive amount of ACTH. Okay, and that ACTH or ACTH like substance which is secreted by the lung tumor is now going to produce a disease which is similar to the Cushing's disease, and this is called as Cushing syndrome. So now the Cushing syndrome is because of a lung tumor, okay, because of excessive secretion of ACTH from a lung tumor. But mind it, this lung tumor, okay, does not normally secrete the ACTH. This lung is not the site of secretion of ACTH. The pituitary is. So what will happen? First, you are going to, this is going to confound the treatment. It is going to make the diagnosis difficult. Okay, the clinician first is going to think that the patient might be a case of a Cushing's disease. Okay, and the tumor might be completely missed. That is why we say that the paraneoplastic syndrome, they confound the treatment. Okay, they confound the diagnosis as well as the treatment. So the first endocrinopathy is the Cushing syndrome. It is seen in tumors like the small cell carcinoma of the lung, pancreatic carcinomas, and the neural tumors. So what is the mechanism? It is because of ACTH or ACTH like substances which are released by these tumors. The second endocrinopathy is syndrome of inappropriate antidiuretic hormone secretion, also called as SIADH. Now this particular syndrome is because of certain tumors like small cell carcinoma of the lung and intracranial neoplasm, and the mechanism is because of secretion of ADH, that is antidiuretic hormone or atrial natriuretic factor, from such tumors. Thirdly is hypercalcemia. Now it is seen with tumors of the breast carcinomas, squamous cell carcinoma of the lung, not the small cell, squamous cell carcinoma of the lung, renal carcinomas, and adult T cell leukemia. So the most important mechanism is because of secretion of parathormone related peptide PTHRP, we say, okay, from these tumors. Other mediators or other mechanisms are release of interleukin-1, TNF, TGF-alpha from the tumors. Now the other endocrinopathies are hypoglycemia. It occurs in ovarian carcinoma, fibrosarcoma, and other mesenchymal sarcomas, and it occurs because of release of insulin or insulin-like substances from these tumors. Next is polycythemia. It is seen in renal carcinoma, hepatocellular carcinoma, and cerebellar hemangioma, and it occurs due to the release of erythropoietin. Okay, release of erythropoietin from these tumors. Lastly, we are having osteomalacia. It is seen in phosphaturic mesenchymal tumors because of the release of FGF23. So this is all about the endocrinopathies. We are going to see few points regarding endocrinopathies. If you see, okay. So endocrinopathy is frequently encountered paraneoplastic syndrome, and here remember the responsible carcinoma, they are not of endocrine origin, as I told you. Okay, in the Cushing's disease, because of the lung cancer, okay, that lung is not an endocrine organ. Okay, so the responsible carcinoma, they are not of endocrine origin, and the secretory activity of such tumor is referred to as ectopic hormone production. So as I told you, the Cushing syndrome is because of release of ACTH, and this ACTH is released from an organ which is not endocrine. So that is why we call it as ectopic hormone production. Okay, so it's ACTH over here is released from the lungs. So the most common endocrinopathy, as we saw over here, is Cushing syndrome. Around 50% of the people who are presenting with Cushing syndrome, they have carcinoma of the lung, mainly small cell type. Okay, so this is basically a patient, how a patient of Cushing syndrome will present to you. Okay, they are having round face, they are having a completely round fluffy face. Okay, so Cushing syndrome occurs due to the increased production of corticotropin. Now this corticotropin can be either ACTH or a ACTH like substance, that is called as corticotropin like peptide. Now the precursor of corticotropin is pro-opiomelanocortin. Okay, it is a pro-opiomelanocortin. So in lung carcinoma patients, you will find increased concentration of not only corticotropin but also increased concentration of pro-opiomelanocortin. Okay, so this is not found in the serum of patients who are having excessive corticotropin, which is produced by pituitary tumors. Okay, so what they are trying to say, a person suffering from Cushing syndrome, okay, Cushing syndrome is because of some tumor, okay, they will have increased levels of pro-opiomelanocortin. Along with that, they will have increased amount of corticotropin also, both. But a person who is suffering from Cushing's disease because of an endocrine disorder, for example, there is a pituitary tumor, in that case, they will have only, you know, excessive amount of corticotropin, okay? There will be no excess amount of pro-opiomelanocortin. So pro-opiomelanocortin is increased in Cushing syndrome, but it is not increased in Cushing's disease. Okay, I hope this point is clear for everyone. Now the next kind of endocrinopathy that we will see is hypercalcemia. But hypercalcemia, it is not a true endocrinopathy in the true sense. Basically, it is the most common paraneoplastic syndrome. So overall, if you see, okay, among all the tumors, hypercalcemia is the most common paraneoplastic syndrome. Very, very important MCQ. Symptomatic hypercalcemia is more often related to cancer than to hyperparathyroidism. Okay, remember, if a patient is having signs, symptoms of hypercalcemia, it is more likely the patient is suffering from cancer than the patient is suffering from any endocrine disorder. For example, hyperparathyroidism. Okay. There are two general processes which are involved in cancer-associated hypercalcemia. One is there is osteolysis. Osteolysis means breakdown of a bone. Osteolysis induced by cancer, whether it is the primary bone tumor, example multiple myeloma, or it is a secondary metastasis to the bone. So this is one way that cancer can induce hypercalcemia. And the second is the production of a calcemic humoral substance by extraosseous neoplasm. So there are certain extraosseous neoplasms. So outside the bone, there is some tumor which is releasing certain hormonal substances which is causing the breakdown of the bone and osteolysis. So remember, only the mechanism number 2 is considered to be paraneoplastic. Only the mechanism number 2 is paraneoplastic, and this is an important MCQ. Hypercalcemia, because of primary or secondary involvement of the skeleton by that primary tumor or the secondary tumor, it is not recognized as a paraneoplastic syndrome. So this should be kept in mind. Okay, now the humoral factor which is most commonly associated with paraneoplastic hypercalcemia is parathyroid hormone related protein called as PTHRP. Remember, it is partially similar to the original parathyroid hormone. Okay, and both, why we are calling that they are similar, because both of them, they bind to a G protein coupled receptor, that is a parathormone receptor, or it is a parathyroid hormone related protein receptor. Like the parathormone related peptide, it increases the bone resorption and causes increased renal calcium uptake, ultimately causing increased serum calcium levels and hypercalcemia. But in contrast to parathormone, the parathormone related peptide is produced in small amount by many normal tissues. For example, the epithelial cell types, including the keratinocytes, that will also produce parathormone related peptide, which explains the association of squamous cell carcinoma of the lung with parathyroid hormone related peptide induced hypercalcemia. So what is happening? Parathormone is just liberated from the parathyroid gland, but the parathyroid hormone related peptide, okay, that is produced by many tissues. That is why whenever there is tumor, for example, there is a squamous cell carcinoma of the lung which is arising from the squamous epithelium, that is the keratinocytes, okay, so even those, they are liberating parathormone related peptide. So when there is a tumor of those cell, okay, for example, in case of squamous cell carcinoma of the lung, there will be increased amount of parathormone related peptide leading to hypercalcemia. Okay, what are the other factors which is causing paraneoplastic hypercalcemia? So apart from parathormone related peptide, what are the other humoral factors? For example, interleukin-1, TGF-alpha, TNF, dihydroxy, vitamin D. Now the most common cancer associated with hypercalcemia is the breast carcinoma, remember. Whereas the most common lung carcinoma associated with hypercalcemia is squamous cell carcinoma of the lung. Other tumors associated with paraneoplastic hyperplasia are renal cell carcinoma and ovarian carcinoma. Now we are going to discuss the second heading of the paraneoplastic syndrome, that is the neuromyopathic paraneoplastic syndrome. So basically over here, the patient is presenting either as peripheral neuropathy or encephalitis or cortical cerebellar degeneration, polymyopathy resembling polymyositis, or myasthenic syndrome, which is resembling the original disease, that is myasthenia gravis. So in all of these basic presentation, the underlying mechanism is that there is a cancer induced immunological attack on the normal tissue. And here the normal tissue is the nerve and the muscles, the neuromuscular system. So what is happening, that the cancer is inducing the formation of antibodies that is going and attacking the neuromuscular system and causing these symptoms. Let us see. First is the myasthenia syndrome. Now it is basically, the syndrome is seen in thymic neoplasm and in bronchogenic carcinoma, and the basic mechanism over here is antibody formation against the post synaptic acetylcholine receptor present at the neuromuscular junction. Similarly, we are having Lambert-Eaton syndrome, which is seen classically in small cell lung carcinoma. Here the basic mechanism is antibody formation against the presynaptic voltage gated calcium channels at the neuromuscular junction. Whereas in opsoclonus myoclonus ataxia syndrome, here it is basically seen in it is classically seen in neuroblastoma in children, and it is seen in small cell lung carcinoma in adults. And here we are having an autoimmune treatment, reaction against the RNA binding protein NOVA1. So remember, it is seen in neuroblastomas in children and small cell lung carcinomas in adult. And the basic mechanism is autoimmune reaction against the RNA binding protein NOVA1. Now we are going to see about the dermatological disorders associated or which is presenting as a paraneoplastic syndrome. Okay, so acanthosis nigricans, it is classically seen in gastric carcinomas, lung carcinomas and uterine carcinomas. And basically the mechanism is immunologic because of the secretion of epidermal growth factor. The second dermatological disorder, okay, which is presenting as a paraneoplastic syndrome, is dermatomyositis, which is seen in bronchogenic carcinoma as well as in case of breast carcinoma, and the mechanism is immunologic. Whereas the sign of lesser trilat, it is classically associated with acanthosis nigricans. It is seen in gastrointestinal adenocarcinoma patient, and it basically presents as sudden onset multiple seborrheic keratosis. Remember, this sign of lesser trilat is associated with acanthosis nigricans. So this is how the acanthosis nigricans present. It is basically a thickening, velvety thickening of the skin, classically seen in the nape of the neck. Okay, so it is characterized by a grayish black patch of thickened hyperkeratotic skin, which is having a velvety appearance. In 50% of the cases, particularly older than age 40, the appearance of such lesion is associated with cancer. So in around 50% of the cases, particularly in people who are older than 40 years, the appearance of such kind of lesion is associated with cancer, and most commonly it is associated with cancer of the stomach, gastric adenocarcinomas. Now, acanthosis nigricans is sometimes accompanied by abrupt development of multiple seborrheic keratosis, which is called as lesser trilat sign. Now we will read about the osseous, articular and the soft tissue changes. Okay, this is another paraneoplastic syndrome. So over here there is a hypertrophic osteoarthropathy and clubbing of the fingers, and classically it is seen in carcinomas of the bronchus, bronchogenic carcinomas and thymic neoplasm, and the mechanism of which is unknown. It is seen in 1-10% patients with lung carcinoma, and classically it is having a triad of periosteal new bone formation, arthritis of adjacent joints, clubbing of the digits. So this is how this hypertrophic osteoarthropathy looks like. There is a clubbing of the fingers, if you can see over here. So remember one thing, that osteoarthropathy, that I showed you right now, it can rarely be also seen in non-cancer patients. In medicine, you are going to read that this clubbing you can see in patients with liver disease, with diffuse lung disease, congenital cyanotic heart disease, and in case of ulcerative colitis. The next paraneoplastic syndrome is the vascular and hematological changes. Number one, we are having the venous thrombosis, that is also called as Strozzi's phenomenon or migratory thrombophlebitis. It is seen in pancreatic carcinoma, bronchogenic carcinoma and other tumors, and the mechanism is it is induced by the tumor products, that is the mucins that is activating the clotting. Okay, the mucins coming from the pancreatic adenocarcinoma or the bronchogenic adenocarcinoma. The next is DIC, disseminated intravascular coagulation. It is seen in APML. APML is acute promyelocytic leukemia. It is a myeloid leukemia. Okay. Also, it is seen in prostatic carcinoma. Again, the tumor products activate the clotting and causes such changes. The other examples are NBT, that is non-bacterial thrombotic endocarditis, which is seen in advanced carcinomas, okay, mucins secreting adenocarcinomas, and again they are causing hypercoagulability. And lastly, we are having red cell aplasia, which is present in thymic neoplasms, the mechanism of which is unknown. Okay, so this is where we complete. Here is where we are going to complete the paraneoplastic syndrome, and we have covered all the paraneoplastic syndrome. Hope you have understood the paraneoplastic syndrome. And just to end, a related topic, okay, which is seen in all cancer patient, is the cancer cachexia. So what is cancer cachexia? It is not related with your paraneoplastic syndrome. It is just a separate entity. So cancer cachexia is basically a hypercatabolic state, which is characterized by loss of muscle mass, which is the cardinal feature, okay, with or without loss of fat. So loss of muscle mass is the more persistent feature. It is the cardinal feature. Now, this cancer cachexia is seen in 50% of cancer patients, most commonly in the GIT, lung and pancreatic carcinoma, which is responsible for 30% of the cancer death. And it is characterized by extreme weight loss, fatigue, muscle atrophy, anemia, anorexia and edema. Now, inflammatory mediators responsible for the cancer cachexia, there are three important ones. One is tumor necrosis factor TNF, interleukin 1 and interleukin number 6. Out of them, if you have to choose one, the answer should be TNF, which is the most common and most important. Now, these cytokines, they increase the degradation of major skeletal muscle structural protein, that is the myosin. And how do they degrade? Via the ubiquitin proteasomal degradation pathway. Okay, remember, the anti-TNF therapy has not been effective effective in reversing the cancer cachexia, meaning that apart from these mediators, other molecules are also involved in cancer cachexia. For example, lipid mobilizing factor is responsible for causing fat loss. So with this, we have completed the cancer cachexia and we are going to conclude today's lecture. Thank you very much for showing your love and support towards this channel. You can contribute via the PayPal link in the description box, www.paypal.me/simplypathology. And if you have any doubts, you can comment in the comment section, and please do share with those in need. Thank you very much, guys, for watching this video. Stay tuned.